we're seeing a very systematic and deliberate attempt on both sides of the Atlantic to attack the rule of law, parliamentary democracy, and free speech.
This is a worldwide attempt to shut down a functional part of journalism, which is absolutely necessary, which is journalism, A, have to be able to talk to the sources, but more to the point, try to get information from them.
What I was trying to do today was to have a much broader pool of distinguished speakers that could really reach right across all the political divides and political opinions and try to get to the truth about what's really important here. And it's been very, very difficult.
This event at the Frontline Club was moved from Chatham House because Chatham House felt that it may embarrass them. Richard Dearlove was invited along to give the government's view, but he dipped out as well.
It's worth noting this year that Chatham House celebrates 100 years of free thinking.
The press has created such confusion that nobody can have an opinion, and they all resort to one thing. He should not have squirreled himself away in that embassy. He should have faced the charges.
I speak Swedish, so I've been able to look at the original investigation reports by the police when they questioned the women that allegedly were involved in this. And there's a written trail where you can see how the police constructed the rape claim and allegation against Julian Assange, where the most important point is that the woman that was purportedly raped went to the police station, she says herself, only to inquire whether she could force Assange to take an HIV test because she had engaged in consensual intercourse with him unprotected, and now she was afraid. But then she sends an SMS, a text message, out of the interrogation to a friend, saying, I don't want to accuse Assange of anything, but the police want to get their hands on him. And the next day she writes a text message saying it was the police that constructed it all, that fabricated it all. So we have evidence of a fabricated accusation that has been around for years and has been completely suppressed by mainstream media.
Once you start to damage the foundations of the pillar, which is the ability of the press and the media to hold the powerful to account through the media. Once you start to break that away, then we effectively become subjects of a totalitarian state.
We're discussing here whether Assange or Craig Murray or someone else has done something wrong or not. But what about the war crimes? We are living in a time when our own war crimes are no longer prosecuted. We know that we have conducted aggressive wars. We've hanged people in Nuremberg for this and in Tokyo. And there's no accountability.
It seems to me that Assange had exposed more wrongdoing than all the rest of us put together.
The prosecution, if it goes forward in the United States, would mean for the first time ever there would be a prosecution for publication. We have never had a prosecution for publication in the history of this country. What the U.S. government wants to do is to make the journalist a passive receptacle of information. That is not journalism. That is common carriage. And there's an important distinction between a journalist who seeks out information and someone who receives it. The last count I have in the United States of documents that were classified was 50 million. And the year before, the number of documents that were classified was 70 million. It's just impossible to have 70 million secrets. It just is totally ridiculous.
We're in the middle of a case right now about whether you can sue when national security is at stake. Well, of course you can. you know, there are ways of redacting anything that's legitimate. What we're not doing at the moment is we have no definition of what's legitimate. So what we need is a real rule. We need several UN conventions. Frankly, we need one on assassination. We need one on classification. We need to have a public debate about what's going on in secret so that there can be an agreement as to what the rules are.
None of us can really handle unchecked power. We need oversight. That's why we have the Fourth Estate, to watch this going on and inform the public, empower them, not entertain them, but empower them, so they can use their democratic rights to keep things in order. If that no longer works, and if we receive freedom of information, you know, documents that are just black, I mean, that's ridiculous. That's not freedom of information.
There was a very interesting case about 6 months ago, when the cables from the British ambassador in Washington were splashed all over the front page of the Mail on Sunday. They were being made with a series of derogatory comments by our ambassador about Donald Trump. It was hugely spun by them in order to turn it into a story. With the case of Assange, you just saw the raw material and you could read it in a judicious way and reach your own conclusion. And Mail on Sunday was strongly defended by Boris Johnson, just become Prime Minister.
The corporate media, brings us into line to support government policy through propaganda. That's one of their main functions. The other function, hopefully, is to, when they see corruption, bring it to our notice so that we may take corrective measures. At the moment, government policy and the convincing us to favour government policy is the major work of corporate media. We hope that that'll change.
And I would like to say that all the government's activities anywhere around the world are benign, but we know they're not benign. They get us into wars, they torture, they shoot Reuters reporters, as Assange pointed out, and the ability of the public to have disclosure of that information is very, very important. Particularly, may I say, as history moves in an authoritarian direction.
If we don't hold ourselves to a rather higher standard than just going around assassinating people, what can we expect the rest of the world to do? When we torture people, what can we expect the rest of the world to do? And it seems to me that's why it's really important to focus on what we're doing to Julian Assange and others, because we have no hope for poor old Nils going around the world trying to get other countries to do the right thing when they constantly say, well, you're doing.
The basis for my mandate to get involved in this, the anti-torture mandate of the UN to get involved in this case, is threefold. First, the publications or the revelations made by WikiLeaks that disclosed, you know, systematic torture being committed by Western forces and their allies in Iraq and in Afghanistan, and obviously also in the 9/11 context, not only torture but also other crimes, you know, and violations of human rights, and that. These are very serious crimes. I mean, some of the most serious crimes, you know, in international law, and they're not being prosecuted at all. And on the other hand, the person that disclosed this information is being prosecuted, Chelsea Manning, and the person who published this information, Julian Assange, and threatened with, you know, potentially 175 years in prison, when, you know, the main war criminals in The Hague receive something like 45 years. So it clearly shows that there's a grotesque disproportion of and double standards that are being applied here.
It's absolutely certain that the case will go to the Fourth Circuit, because that is where the grand jury sits. That's where poor Chelsea Manning is. We've forgotten about her, as I noted earlier, is in jail. And therefore, it will be an uphill fight, because I don't know anyone who's won a national security case in the Fourth Circuit.
So here we have WikiLeaks, who has never, ever published false information. And the person being, even true information about serious crimes that are not being prosecuted.
You're dehumanizing this person to the point where they don't become a human being anymore. He will just become the symbol stuck in 175 years of concrete. And what that symbol would say is, this is what will happen to you if you dare to publish the truth about American war crimes.
Once this precedent has been allowed to be established, it can be applied to anyone. And, you know, you and your children can be kidnapped, handed over to torture, tortured and massacred, and no one will ever ask a question, or no one will ever be held accountable. And that's why this is important for all of us.
When his trial starts, we want to try and attract as many people as possible down to the court, talk to your MP, talk to the media, try as far as possible to put this issue at the top of the agenda, because it's absolutely crucial.
It is now in the hands of the people, because the institutions and the governments won't do anything about it.